Mic check. 1, 2, 1, 2, 3. It's Cosmo D here on the microphone. Saturday, midday, New York City. Can people hear me? If you can, let it be known in the chat. If I am sitting at the same level as the music, let me know. If I'm too loud or if I'm too soft, let me know. Those of you who are here early, I'm gonna give you a little treat. This is my window of work for Tales from Off Peak City. I'm just gonna give you a little look around, show you some of the gameplay. There's the menu to the pizza spot. We're gonna step outside. You're gonna take a look at the city a little bit. Still work in progress. There's a lot of lighting I need to get right, but it's running well. I've been able to sort of test the game top to bottom, and it works. Graphical errors aplenty, but at least you kind of get a sense of the world and what I'm trying to capture here. Spot. So and those two people talking. So I think that's about as much as I'm going to show for now, because I don't want to give too much away. But there it is. I'll be right back. Yeah, the fog on the distant city was inspired by the Fritz Lang Metropolis poster. To sort of give a sense of, yeah, that there's more going on in the background. Galactic T has a question, 480p. I don't know what that's referring to. I should be broadcasting at the highest setting. Thank you. Alright, we're gonna start in about 3 minutes. Because I wanna get to all the games. Glad we got that sorted out with the stream. Yeah. Check 1 2 1 2. Greetings. It's Cosmo D. Turn down this backup music. Hello. Thanks everybody to making the stream, and more importantly, thanks everybody who submitted games to the jam. I'm looking forward to showing these games and talking about them a little bit. I will try to get through every game. I don't think I can play every game top to bottom, but I would like to give every game a shine and, kind of talk about what it made me think about and, what some of the connections I've seen to my own city experience and the work I'm doing right now. So I'm going to start with this game. I might be saying it wrong. Mene, mene, tekel, up, a parson. I assume that's Gaelic because the person that posted this is, I guess he's from Ireland. There's a story here to this game. I am curious to kind of get a bit more of the backstory. I'm going to just jump right in. So yeah, this game's interesting because basically you're going around just tagging, and it looks like it's late at night. It's in Belfast. I really do appreciate the detail here being used to put you in this back alley. I feel like whoever was planning this out knows this city, knows the environments here. They know the background. So yeah, I'm just gonna do some tagging. This spray paint effect is pretty impressive. I think the creator just kind of is spawning a ton of these sort of paint decal objects, but it actually works really well. And I have a choice between black and red. So I'm gonna just make something. So yeah. So just very subtle sound design here. You can hear from the left channel. No music, no people, some other political commentary here. I feel like this alleyway, this Belfast alleyway, feels very well known. Like this person mapped this alleyway from his youth in his mind. It's like mapped permanently, and he's bringing it into this virtual space. The moon's a nice touch. All the debris. I imagine that this is what an actual Belfast City Council bin looks like. I think it's interesting that the city council's name is on a trash bin. You don't really see that a lot with waste in New York. It's usually just the Department of Sanitation, and it's not the city council. The city council is handling less mundane affairs, but nope, the Belfast City Council is what is responsible for Belfast's waste management. So let's get back to that main screen. Hold on. So this is basically... Oh! Is there something here that I... No, I was already here. So let's go to the final screen. I think it's this way. Yeah. Does it appear... Oh, yeah. It's like a bit of a maze. It feels like a bit of a thief level. Okay, let's try this. Ah, okay, so this is the sort of the main kind of reveal of this game. East Belfast Battalion. And you're sort of spray painting on this. I am curious to know a bit more about the history. Developer, if you're watching, I'd really like, chime in on your itch page about this a bit more. What all this means and what this meant to you. There's a British flag, so clearly there's some tension there. I don't know what flag that is, the UV something. But like there's some environmental storytelling going on here. There's some real politics, real drama, real history, and I gotta commend I think it was Andrew Pope made this. So yeah, bravo, really good work. It's a simple game, it has a simple mechanic, but it's just executed very nicely for the scope that it is. The spray paint sound is really good. It's just subtle details executed well, and then you sort of get to this main wall. And I also like the idea that players are imparting their own sensibility on the game. So, they could make a really elaborate piece of art, somewhat elaborate, two colors on a wall, but that's their way of leaving their mark in the game world. So, I think that's really great. I think that's a strong piece of work. So, the next game I want to get into is... And I hope I'm saying this right. Theama Neon, A Journey Through a City of Neon Light. So I'm going to launch that. And yeah, let me know if the levels are weird or anything. Just keep me posted. But this is gonna have a bit more sound, so. So immediately we're sort of dropped off in this 3D space. Very striking kind of neon look. Really interesting use of geometry here. Kind of sets you up for the off-peak purgatory experience. You're in a train station or you're in a sort of train depot and you're sort of here. And they say, go to the bar, have a drink, maybe go to the hotel. Let's go downstairs. So the challenge of making a game like this is that you create a lot of space. Unlike the last game, Mayday, I'm gonna just shorthand it. This game, you create a lot of space, and there's this sort of temptation to fill it, or at the very least, try to fill it, and then be overwhelmed by its vastness, or maybe put in one thing, and hope that that kind of fills it in the minds of the player. This is something I dealt with a lot in Off-Peak. I created this space and I was worried it was too big after a while, so I filled every corner with something. And here, I wonder if the developer struggled with that in this. Because, you know, it's just something that we are confronted with when we have all this space. Or if the developer was like, okay, I'm gonna be cool with the fact that there's a lot of openness here. Oh yeah, okay. Well, there you go. Not well liked at this place. Interesting. Think the music is very fitting. I think that works well with the atmosphere. I do want to hear some more kind of ambient sound. I think if I was going to work on this, I would think about like maybe the sounds of planes overhead and wind and some electronics in the slot machines. Yeah, I really like the way that the emission in this room worked out. It kind of naturally bled into the room overall. My question for the developer, technical question, is this a traditional baking situation where you used sort of the old school style, or is this real-time light map? I really like the way that the emission spreads on the ceilings of this space. Oh, we get some bottles here. Ooh, trains are running again. When I played this the first time, I went to the hotel. But it looks like it's just on a timer. It's not waiting for me. It's not waiting for me necessarily to do everything. It's just sort of like that's there for me to do. But if I do want to sort of leave the game, I can do that. Yeah, oh, and I went into the hotel before. I recommend everybody play this and just kind of discover for themselves where all these corners lead. The last comment I want to make about this particular game is that I almost did this in Off-Peak. I almost actually had, rather than actual figures, I had sort of stand-in models that would look sort of like dummies or mannequins that didn't have distinctive features, but I opted for distinctive features instead. But I still feel like this is effective enough. I feel like for the time window that you had, you made the most of it. So let's interact. Sure. Fatal Neon. Lantern Empire. Okay, so there's a bit of a Bandcamp situation. Cool. Okay, so the next game I want to play is The White Diner. If anyone has any questions for me, I am open. So I feel like The White Diner is... I laughed a lot playing The White Diner because I feel like Hog Sandwich really took a lot of my approaches and put his own twist on them. I feel a lot of kind of an exchange of ideas between, you know, whether it's the art on the wall, the sort of collage approach, the fact that it's in this sort of dining establishment, good strong atmosphere. I like these wood planks, I like this plate. I like that you're eating pancakes, and the tutorial, you know, you really went out of your way to tutorialize this. So yeah, let's eat some pancakes. These are really well textured pancakes. I'm really hungry, just eating these pancakes. And this guy, this guy's like the recurring theme. There's been some, we got the aviator shades. There's been some celebration of the music of the residents and that whole. That whole scene and that whole community, and I'm getting residence vibes from this game. Like, who's this guy in the top hat? This feels like a that 90s residence experience. And here we go. Here's where it really kicks in high gear. Yeah, this cutout, great detail on the cutout of. This door frame is that guy, and then he's looking at me. I feel like people get freaked out when I do this in my game, and when this happened to me, I was like, oh yeah, okay, you got me. Like, I see why that freaks people out. When you're doing the freaking out, it's different. When you're the one getting freaked out, it's like, okay, I see why. Really like this chanting. I think whenever you put actual voice in a game, people are connected to voice. And I'm learning that as I experiment with voice in Tales from Off City. So yeah, okay. Gorilla looking through and some pyramids. I mean, the collage approach here is really playful. And I really encourage Hawk Sandwich to keep going down this road. I like that there's so many layers, foregrounding, backgrounding to all the little tableaus that are here. Yeah. The particle effects are a nice touch. I think that's a good use of you know, creating movement, even more movement. I really want to know. I want to know what's going on with this diner Hawk Sandwich. I want to know what your thoughts are here. What your inspiration was for the choices you made. You know, why the pyramid? Why the gorilla? Like, you know, one thing I try to do in my games is when I have. When I put things in a room, in my mind, I'm always saying, well, there's a reason why they're there. Like, even in Norwood's suite, like, there was the lemons, or the fruit in the hallway. I always felt like, well, that fruit was a gift, a series of sculptures that were given to Norwood from one of his fans when he was playing his music abroad. And so he took those sculptures and he put those in his hallway as a decoration. So, I think having a... even if you're not telling it directly, you can tell it to somebody in your head. I think that's a good start. Like, why is that wallpaper there? If you can kind of narratively justify, oh, well, maybe that guy in the top head just really likes collecting the these illustrations. Like, I think that's enough, and that continues to help you build out the world. And he has pictures of himself inverted. So yeah, clearly there was some shenanigans here. You were probably involved. Maybe my favorite detail in this whole game is this trapdoor, because the trapdoor implies something. Like, did he get away? Did somebody crawl out of it? Is there more to explore? Like, you create a trapdoor in the floor here, and all of a sudden, you imply that there's this other direction. So yeah, this was really satisfying to play for me. Not just because I was sort of seeing how my work influenced yours, Hawk Sandwich, but also because it's good to see, you know, a lot of the design sensibilities that I'm kind of winging when I make games. I'm seeing them working in here. I like, you know, the use of font in the 3D space, and the really strong use of tutorialization. Even the menu screen is really well considered. Like, this menu screen is a class act, and I think, you know, we take it for granted, menu screens like this, but when you see it in a game that's like made for a jam or made on a kind of a short time frame, you appreciate it. So good work. Very pleased with that. Cool. So let's see, what do I want to play next? I want to play The Empty Lot. Let's see if I can run it. So I'm not going to play too much of this. There's no sound. But I am, let's see, I have to move it. I have to clear some things out of. This is part of the awkwardness of some of the games, is that they don't run in full screen. So you just kind of have to play them as you do. So, okay, here's The Empty Lot. This, I thought narratively this was really strong. And you basically, it's a Bitsy game. And I don't know a ton about Bitsy, but Bitsy, you can make these really small games in HTML, and you're just, you can get a lot out of not a lot. And this is a really strong hook, a really interesting story, really great kind of minimalist use of control, and you know, everything that's interactable is just blinking. It's just like really, really strong. I mean, again, I don't really want to play too much of this. I just, if you haven't played this, it can run on anything. And it just has a really great setup, and you play through it, so more of the story unfolds. It feels like a really strong visual novel. I don't know if the developer is able to put sound in Bitsy games, or if that's, you know, within the scope of what you want to do. You don't really need it. You could probably just put some background music on. And that's enough. It's basically like reading a living visual novel, and it has a great setup, and I strongly suggest that everybody play it. This is The Empty Lot. So yeah, shout outs to yeah. So I'm going to leave it for that, because I think it's a game to be discovered on your own. Let's see what's next. Next is Into Dust. Let's play Cosmo Stream version of Into Dust. The developer has been making a lot of updates since the end of the jam. You know, good job continuing to maintain this game. I think it's got a lot of really strong strong aspects to it. Now there's going to be some voiceover. This is the one game that was added with voiceover. I was really struck by the voiceover. Okay, here we go.
It looked like the sky was blushing at me. But to my dad, he thought he was going to collapse in and choke us.
Yeah.
Jordan wasn't returning texts. That wasn't unusual. I was scared she walked off too.
Hey, I just wanted to see how things were. If you're free, call me, okay? Okay, bye.
Yeah, the world building in this is really interesting. It sets up this kind of post-apocalyptic space.
I knew she would have left something behind for me to find. People are leaving things attached to memories wherever they were going.
It's world building and relationship.
There was a father who left his wife and daughter. He left a bank account for them and a note that said they could keep the property they bought together.
Dad's freaking out about the dust. You're probably fine, but just let me know.
If somebody in the chat wants to link to the page where all the games are, itch.io page, yes, they're all available to play on itch.io, and they're all really, really great in how they deal with the city. Like this, again, it's using the train station as a sort of setting motif. It's going
to
keep changing.
Some people went back to somewhere that meant something.
But this is just a lot of poetry here, you know, in terms of the lines that are said, when they're said, what you can do, just sitting, waiting.
I've got the car this afternoon, so if you want a lift back to the station, just let me know.
Let's see, let's see how far I get. It's gonna change scenes. This kind of looks at, it's like a, everybody
Things
left.
Things were tough. It wasn't surprising that people were finally turning in.
Life Fitness, is that a real brand? Yeah, so world building, relationship building, right out of the gate.
Did you go to the pool? I'm down for a dip after work.
Bit of foreshadowing now that I've played this and I can kind of see.
I don't understand how people could leave so much.
So one thing that I'll just recommend.
That was 8 years ago.
Yeah. Simple guitar loop, but very effective.
People said they would reappear places they loved. Jordan's was a pool.
I really like the way that the sort of game verb of putting up posters is really effective in conveying, you know, what's going on in the world.
I got a call from the posters. Someone had lost their mother during the dust storm. She knew I didn't have the answers, but I was someone to hear her out.
These are simple.
I wanted Jordan to notice this.
Jordan.
I didn't think the dust storm would come back, but I'm standing here now, the place me and Jordan came before she left. I'd always push her to just go for it, but she cried because her visa had been denied twice now. She stood at the edge. Her toes were afraid of the needle. I'm taking the day off, she said. I found out later that everybody had been let go.
So I'm at the pool. I think I can click on one of these chairs, but I'm not sure. This has a really strong sense of sort of unsettling, overwhelming. I love these tiles. Kind of makes me think, who designed this pool? Yeah, let's sit down. So Jay, who's been on the server and who's been developing this, you're probably seeing what I'm doing, and I think you're recognizing this as some sort of bug, which is how I've recognized a lot of my bugs have been through watching people streaming my game and me being like, oh no, don't, oh no, the bugs that I should have fixed. But that's okay. It's actually a useful feedback. But it's still, I mean, other people might play this and they might get a little further. I might have caused some sort of null reference exception. I don't know. People who develop know potentially what happens here. But I still think this is really tremendous. It's really effective. And I look forward to this continuing to iron itself out in time and basically, you know, blossom into its full potential. So, yeah, great job. Let's see, what's the next one? So this one is called You Can Fall in Love. You Can Fall in Love. This might not work. This is actually by a friend of mine named Blake. And let's see if I can't load it from... Yeah, You Can Fall in Love. Let's see. Oh, yeah. This might be a bad idea. Blake, I might... Sorry, Blake. I don't... This... It just turned my computer into... It wasn't very happy. We might have to pass on You Can Fall in Love, but it's a cool mood piece. You can play it on the site. We'll keep moving. Gigolo Sim by The Last Yuri Samurai. Now, it's an interesting one. I might have to get out of full screen. Okay, so I don't know what was this made in RPG Maker? Was this made in Game Maker? I think this is really interesting because it's a play on Stardew Valley. I think there's a bit of a Stardew Valley vibe with this game, but it's about becoming a male escort. I mean, sure, why not? It was definitely Gigolos. And it's you know, it's a pretty impressively detailed simulation of life as a gigolo. I think there's a story behind what inspired the developer to make this, and I'm intrigued because it's all there. I think there's actually a lot of gameplay here, and there's like day night cycles, and you talk to all these people. Let's talk to this guy. He's just steroids. Okay, I mean, why not? You know, this is a facet of city life too. You know, there's a lot. I mean, if you want to have a sort of Stardew Valley-esque subversive city life simulator experience, try Gigolo Sim. I mean, I think it's one of those games that sort of you can just, there's a couple of different layers to this in terms of the commentary and in terms of, and I just snuck into the fence in terms of this crazy guy in a cage, pay 1,000. I don't even think I have 1,000. Nope. So apparently I'm going to get money, and I don't know. This is all of this made in a day. This shows that if you have, I'm curious to see how familiar the developer was with this toolbox, because they put a lot of content in here. And I think it's really interesting where if the toolbox is really easy to use, and the, you know, the sprites, like the less you need to do, it's a 2D game, the more content you can put in. And I think that serves a game like this really well. So shout outs to Yuri the Last Samurai for you know, going there with Gigolo Sim. So bravo. So let's get back to the list here. The City Haze. I'm gonna launch the City Haze. This is a game by Argia. I hope I'm pronouncing that right. Yeah, you can. Gigolo Sim's got a lot of granular detail. It's really, I'm really impressed by it. Okay, so the music's running. I think it doesn't run in full screen, so I just have to go back here. What shall it profit for a man if he gain the whole world, suffer the loss of his city? So this is kind of a philosophical game about, you know, walking the city, talking to people. Yeah, just, I think it's really interesting because it's so, you know, you can explore this really granular space and just kind of go every which way. And when you meet people, they tell you kind of real-life philosophical musings about life in the city, or what people have said about the city. And I know that the developers talked about potentially bringing more, you know, user-generated quotes in there. And I think that's great. This actually reminds me a lot of Burn Band, with the sort of flat shading and these people. Any pose that is an arch will open the chest cavity and is excellent for energizing the city. Like, who said these things? This is really great. For it was not into my ear you whispered, but into my heart. It was not my lips you kissed, but my city. It's great. Really on theme. Really cool, kind of unified aesthetic with this sort of mid-90s pixelated texture mapping, 2.5D, and then the quotes. And so I felt like this was a strong, you know, thematic. It got to the idea of, like, ruminating on the idea of the city, you know, thinking about actually pondering, you know, what the city is and what it's about. So yeah, really, really cool, really interesting twist. And I think that's been what I've liked about all these games in the jam, is that they're so distinct from one another in how they approach the city and what it means to them, and how that they then turn, how they turn their thoughts about the city into creative work and are then inspired by my own work, which and other work too, of course. So I thought that's why this jam was so interesting to me. So let's see, what else, what's next? Pedestrians. This is by another friend of mine, Flan, who rolls with Blake. Sorry again, Blake. I say just check out You Can Fall in Love in the jam site. It was linked in the chat. This is, where is it? Is this the right? No. City Haze, Pedestrians. Okay, so we're playing Pedestrians. We're gonna keep it short, because it's a little loud. There's like a really loud scream, so you might want to turn down your volume. I'm actually, yeah. You're basically like in a... Oh yeah, oh yeah. That was... Sorry, folks. That was a bit loud. I'm just turning it down. But yeah, you're basically... Whenever these creatures get hit, they let out a giant scream, and you're going around, basically watching that happen, and it's kind of this this generative pedestrian simulator with cars, and it's a real problem in New York. So but yeah, that's another one I think you can play kind of at your own pace and at your own volume, because it also simulates a lot of really loud sound. But the truth is, it's when you get hit by a car, it comes at you loud and fast. And unfortunately, I could speak to some experience there, but that's another story for another time. We'll keep going here. Phone Call Home. There's three more games. So Phone Call Home. Let's see. This was probably the most... describe this game. I'm actually gonna avoid these robots because the blaster is also pretty loud. This game is interesting because it had a really elaborate mission structure, and I felt really lost. But I think that was the intent of the design. I felt really lost in this space. All of these buildings are like the same. And then there's robots chasing you everywhere. So in a sense, oh boy, like that guy. Let's see if I can escape this robot. So yeah, this game is pretty intense because you're trying to like repair a derelict command tower. I think this took me about an hour to play. No joke. I mean, I was in it, and it had a day-night cycle, which I really appreciated. And yeah, it was a survival game. I mean, it was a proper raw kind of rough survival game, and definitely interesting. The way that I sort of connected it to the city was that it was, you know, you just feel lost in this space. I don't know, like that's a real thing to feel. I know what it's, you know, I've been in cities that I'm not aware of that I'm just lost. I'm like, where am I going? And then seeing the sun go down, and it kind of adds to that. So definitely a cool approach there. So the Path of Terror, let's see if I can open the Path of Terror. I don't think I can. Oh, here we go, the Path of Terror. Yeah, the architecture in that game is really cool, and it just had a, it was like brutal in its sort of like monotony, and then the robots are chasing you. It was cool. So here's the Path of Terror. This is extremely minimalist in its aesthetic. I'm not sure what quite this has to do with the city. This may, I mean, if the developer is watching, feel free to chime in. Definitely more of a just straight lo-fi horror game. But it kind of has its own internal logic. Very oppressive, running through a maze, some mysterious symbols, some blood. Enter a portal. make your choice. Make this choice. Gotta enter some codes. Oh, go back. Some riddles. Yeah, I think this developer, you know, if he continues to make games of this vein, he could probably, make the bottles a little more hi-fi, because his sort of logic to what's going on, oh yeah, Luno, is there. You know, it's like you explore, you find stuff, you type in codes, they're correct. Code Sole. Correct. All right. Is that it? Anyway, that's this game. It has a couple of branching paths. It has a couple of spooky scares. I am curious to know what it had to do with the city, and where the overlap is. And I look forward to the developer chiming in on that. Yeah, there's a jump scare. There's robots. I wonder. I mean, probably a more circumspect jam policeman might be like, is this really for the jam? But again, I kind of want to know. I want to know what the developer has to say. Maybe they had some thoughts about it. And I want to give the developer the benefit of the doubt. At least for this one. Cool. So now we come to the final one. This is Espectro City. This is the winner of the jam. And congrats to McCore for making this. This is quite an achievement, because it was so kind of fully realized. You know, it sets up the world. It kind of feels like I don't know if anybody here has played the new Hypnospace Outlaw, or games where basically you're navigating a let's see. Turn up the music a little bit. You're navigating a UI, like an OS UI. There's tickets around the city. I appreciate the off-peak reference. Yeah, ticket. I was kind of relieved when there were only. There were less ticket pieces. I was like, oh man, there's 8 ticket pieces. But this is a game to really discover on your own. I love how, well, there's the first ticket piece, one, right? Nice and easy. Ghosts, people to talk to, things to scroll. Like this has got some Hypnospace vibes, but it's very self-contained. It's got clues all over the place. I mean, this is like, you know, it clearly knew what it was doing. McCore, and, you know, I don't know, McCore, if you were the only person involved in making this, or if you had a crew that was making it with you, or, oh, there's another ticket. But this was, I thought this was really impressive in just how fully realized this was within the time constraints, and how much you could do within kind of a limited space of interactivity, which is, you know, all I'm doing is clicking around this sort of quasi-faux desktop, but that feels like an adventure in and of itself, which kind of makes me think, you know, computer desktops are, you know, depending on how sloppily organized they are, can be a bit of an adventure. Mine is so-so. I've you know, worked in studios where the desktops were total maze, and navigating to get to the files I needed were definitely an adventure. Here, everything's really nicely laid out. There's my tickets. But yeah, I just really like that, what you can do, how much depth you can put into an experience with not a lot of you know, 3D or a ton of images, or, you know, it's like you have this sort of ghost model, but that's okay. Her name is List. She's a ghost. She's in the hotel. I think this is really good at letting the player's imagination do a lot of the heavy lifting. And, yeah, how about, so can I ask you, what your engine was? I think you may have mentioned it in the Game Jam chat room, but I'm curious what you used to make this. The catalog in the vinyl collection is really... Clearly, this is somebody that thinks a lot about their vinyl collection. Why vinyl? Since 1991, underground, hip-hop, jazz, soul, new age, and rock you love. This feels like a real music store that I know about that may or may not be still in business, but yeah. Is this based on a real store in your city, Mekor? Ha! Dishwashers and washing machines. Sounds like Matmos. You know, again, this is, I think, props to the designers and the team that made this. I'm going to kind of leave it there because I think this is such a good... I think this is something you should all discover. A lot of, you know, a small crew made this. Bravo. Really happy with how that came about. Game Maker Studio. There you go. I personally haven't used Game Maker, but it's a great tool. Bravo to all the submissions. I kind of did this on a whim, or I did this sort of on an inkling that this was something that might make people want to make stuff, and they did. And I'm really happy with what I saw. So what I want to do now is actually... For a couple of minutes, I'm going to open my Unity project up, and I'll give you all a little preview of what I'm working on. This is my city jam. It's taken a lot longer than a month, unfortunately, but I think you might find it interesting. So I'm just gonna. This is Tales from Off-Peak City, this little preview. I'm just going to get right into it. And I think it should play the audio. It's going to maximize on play. I'm experimenting with a new sort of head model. I think I've posted this earlier. Oh, they're looking at me. Let's see. Yeah, so this is the city that I'm making. Yeah, I'm going to post it one. I'm going to open up one more file here. Music. Yeah, I need the music. I need to. This is what I work in. As you can see, it's Unity. I'm going to flip some levers just to get the setup just so. One. Let's reset all the counters. We'll put this at one, and I think we should be ready to go. This is like the pizza shop. So yeah, this is something I'm experimenting with. Photogrammetry heads versus my old school models. I'm curious to know what you guys think of that. A little bit of a tutorial. We're gonna step out into the world. Here's the city. Part of it. Oh, these guys aren't here. I gotta put those guys back. Okay, so we gotta load one more thing. The characters. Gotta load the characters. Some of these characters are missing. So yeah, this is the city, the corner of July Avenue and Yam Street. It's actually a canal. That's some newer level design work I'm doing. It's a bit of a, so you can buy items now. It's a camera, the old camera. We don't have enough money to buy it. This is what you've been seeing the whole time. I can smell that pizza from here. So we got some talking buildings. People had some questions about what I modeled in my architecture. I do it all in Blender. I do the entire, I did it just straight up Blender style. I didn't know that GoldenEye used photogrammetry. That's really cool. I mean, it's, you know, Robert Yang, to his credit, is like, yeah, like, think about Paratopic, and some of you saw my Paratopic stream, so that's definitely been kind of an influence there. Once again, using diegetic music, although I don't have that one hooked up yet. Guy's still drinking Blue Moose. This hat's for sale. You might know what this hat's from. A bone xylophone. You know, because some people just want to get rid of their bone xylophone. Car models are a work in progress. There's the distant city. And I think that'll do it. So, I think I'm going to leave it at that. Thank you, everybody, for tuning into the stream. I thought that was it was good to celebrate all the submissions. You know, stay on the forums, play the games. I'm glad you guys are into the photogrammetry heads, because I kind of want to keep moving in that direction. I think it's a good way of making people connect to the characters even more. There's Dustin from the last game. Am I using him as a placeholder, or is he just going to have changed jobs and shown up in the city? I wonder. But in the meantime, I think that'll be it. I'm going to put on some music, put the music back on, and we will fade out. So yeah, catch me on the stream. Catch me in the chat on the forums anytime. We are at 400 people strong. I don't know how many of those people are real people, but that's okay. Enough of them have shown themselves to be very real and very cool and very down with what's happening in the community. So yeah, I'm gonna keep revealing more as I keep getting to a better place with my work. Really happy with all of the submissions thus far. I will show you where in the game I'm gonna put the top three submissions. It's gonna be kind of on this like high scores board in one of the buildings. It's gonna kind of look like at bowling alleys where you see, top, 1998, like community bowling champion goes to Mahor, and et cetera, et cetera. So, and there'll be hopefully more jams where there'll be more leaderboards. You can more parts of the leaderboard will be over time. It'll continue to establish itself. So that's it. I'm going to end the stream. Thanks everybody for tuning in. This is going to be archived, so people can watch this retroactively. And more to come. Enjoy your Saturday.